There's nothing worth more that would ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I taste it. Of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my chain is undone by your presence, Lord. Sing, Holy Spirit.
Of the sweetest. King of all days, oh so highly exalted. God, we stand here in reverence for you. Lord, will we never forget how much it costs for our freedom. In your name, amen. Please be seated.
Love the nation. Hana Hayao. Le Ahodo.
That's my land. Ina Natu Mashiha. Bara de Haleha.
Anea na.
Good fall. Mashlam.
Second Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21 says, for our sake, God made Christ to be sin. For our sake, God made Christ to become sin. He knew no sin. But because of that in him, we might become the righteousness of God. A modern parable. Let's imagine for a moment that you are the younger sibling and you have an older brother and you love this older brother. Your father is always telling you, listen to your brother. Spend time with your brother. Be attached. Go with him. Learn from him. And you love it. Because never once does your older brother ever do anything but make you feel valued, make you feel loved. It's almost as if when you're with your brother, you have a greater understanding of who you are, and you can embrace the love of your family and your father even more. You love moments where you get to go with your brother, your family. So you're excited on the day that your dad says, let us all go into town. We're leaving country. We're going to go into town. And as you're going, the father quickly says, now listen, stay close to your brother. There will be a lot of things in town. The music, the food, the colors, the sights, the sounds. It will be alluring, but make sure you stay close to your brother. There'll be a lot of people there. And you don't even know what that's like until you get there. And because of the festivities and all the action and activities, it's overwhelming. You get out of the car and the wave of smells and sounds hits you, and it's so alluring. You're captivated. There's entertainment. There's sights. There's things you've just are so drawn to. And it's almost as if by mesmerizing, you're drifting closer and closer to those sounds and the smells. And the you can imagine tasting the food, especially when you haven't eaten all day and you're hungry. You don't realize that you've actually wandered away in pursuit of all these things. You drifted away from your brother. But there's someone who's been watching the whole time. You see, this abductor has been watching and waiting for you to get out of that car. They have seen you step away. They saw you as you were close. They saw that as you were captivated by everything, they waited for you to get away from the protection of your brother so that they would, the abduction could take place. And quickly, before you know it, you are captured, you're put back in a different car, and you're driven off to a different place. And before you even know it, you're sitting alone in a dark room, terrified because you're so far away from everything else you've known. You're scared. And the minutes turn into hours, and the hours turn into one day, a second day. The hunger, you almost feel as if your stomach is eating upon itself. You're cold. You're tired, but you can't sleep. And you're shocked when the door immediately opens up. And the captor says, you need to leave. Now, you don't understand. You're confused. You're groggy. You were worn out. You were exhausted. But you slowly, with aching bones, even for a child, you get up and you run away. And as you run towards the front door, you can see through the front door being opened. Across the front yard is your father and your brother. And like a magnet, you were drawn to them. And so you begin sprinting with the energy you have left towards your brother and your father. Your brother starts running towards you, and then he slows down to a walk. And as you're expecting an embrace from him, he walks right by you. You don't understand what's going on, because he's heading towards the house that you're running from. The very terrors that have captivated you for days, he's going toward as you make your way towards the father, confused. You look at your father and you say, what's going on? Your father says, in order for you to be made free, your brother became the ransom. Right at that moment, your stomach is now in your throat. You can't stop the sobbing. You feel like you want to vomit, but your tongue is stuck to the roof of your mouth. Your father takes you home, but you can't rest. You're confused. You don't understand what's going on still. You still can't eat. And the minutes turn into hours, and the hours have now turned into one day, 2 days. On the third day, there is a knock at your door. You're startled, but as you go, you're a little careful because you have been completely stretched at this point. And as your family opens up the door, your brother is at the doorway. But he looks different now. There is a aged to him, not older, just maturity to him. And when he opens his mouth, he sounds different. Where he once sounded like a loving, cherished, warm thing, the warmness is there, but there is a sternness now to the voice. As he almost answers the question before you ask and says, we don't need to worry about the abductor anymore. I've killed him. And with his hand stretched, you see that part of his rib cage has been split open. And you notice that his hands are bleeding and his feet are bleeding. And it seems like his eyes burn like the sun. He who knew no sin became sin so that we could be declared righteous. In the days of the wilderness, the Israelites were out in the desert. And because they were out in the wilderness, they were surrounded by enemies all the time. So in order to protect themselves while they were traveling to the promised land, they were not in the promised land yet, they would live in a camp. And the camp was set up in such a way where as long as they were close and they were in the camp, they would be protected. In fact, if you were to take a larger view of the camp setting, everything was set up where while they were in the wilderness, as long as they were in the camp, everything was okay. But they had to stay in the camp. Outside of the camp was the sheer wilderness. The threat of wild animals, giants, enemies were waiting and lurking in the darkness outside the camp. As long as you were in the camp, everything was fine. But you mustn't go outside of the camp. However, in the Old Testament, certain individuals by themselves were told to go outside of the camp. If you had some kind of disease, you had to go outside of the camp. If there was an issue where you would bleed, you had to go outside of the camp. If you had a certain lifestyle that was against the laws, you had to leave the camp. You were not allowed because you were seen as unclean. Some of you may be thinking, yes, but that's the Old Testament. What does Jesus do in the New Testament? Interestingly enough, in the New Testament, places like Luke 17, we see that someone with a skin disease is touched by Jesus. And the person with the disease is made clean. A few chapters earlier, in chapter 15, there is a woman who has an issue of blood. She will not stop bleeding. Now imagine for the moment, you're the leper. And because of what you have on your skin, because of the way you look, you were shunned from humanity and you were sent to live outside the camp. And you have to fend for your own. Your food comes from your own. Where you sleep comes from your own. Nothing can be given to you. In danger of being made unclean. You're bleeding. The embarrassment of that. The constant anemic feeling of that. And you're shunned to go outside the camp. There's a woman who is used by the religious authorities as a recreational tool. She is caught in this adulterous act. She is brought out in the middle of that act, by the way, thrown out to the streets. John tells us that Jesus touches her and pronounces her cleanliness. This is so odd. This is not what we're taught about in the Old Testament because we're taught that if you're unclean, you have to go outside of the camp. That's what keeps the camp pure. That's what keeps God holy. Last week we were told that holiness means separate, set apart. The camp must be kept. Justice must be served. Right must be preserved. So what happens to the uncleanliness? Maybe you're thinking that it just disappears. Maybe you're sitting here tonight thinking, well, like magic, it's just gone. Or maybe you do what a lot of us do. I'll just erase all the bad things. No. The uncleanliness has to be dealt with. The injustice has to be justified. A punishment has to be served. Right needs to be taken place. But it has to go to someone. The Old Testament tried with animals. There was a lamb sacrificed, and a goat was let escape. It's where we get our term scapegoat from. So something has to be done with this. Where does the uncleanliness go? Or maybe you're even thinking, the Old Testament is wrong. Things are messed up. You know, that is an archaic way. In fact, that's an ancient way that doesn't survive in today's modern world, right? You would even find yourself almost mocking that somebody would have to go through this. Now, we wouldn't say that we're mocking. We would not place the crown on his head ourselves. But yet, with our actions and our attitudes, we think that is ancient, barbaric, archaic, not for those of us in a modern, educated, awakened mindset. Surely, this is something that is old and wrong. There's got to be some other answer. Maybe the Bible is out of touch with what really is taking place. Or maybe you think that Jesus is just a good luck fairy that comes around and waves his wand and it just magically dissipates. No. Tonight, we need to recognize that he carries it. And he carries it on the back of a wooden cross after the top layer of his skin is removed, the splinters and the wood digging into him. Then he is stabbed and beaten, and then he is suffocated because he cannot breathe the way he is hanging. It has to be dealt with. In order for God to remain just, there must be a payment for the rebellion everyone in this room has done. He who knew no sin, in the syntax of the Greek, says he became the very essence of sin. He takes that on. He becomes that himself. He fulfills Old Testament law. You see, if you were to take a map of the time of Jesus' life of Jerusalem, you would see that the central part of the city is where the Dome of the Rock is currently today. You would also see that there's the city of David. These were considered during Jesus' time as the camp. And if you'll take a look, you'll see that Calvary's Hill, where he's crucified, is where? Outside the camp. Where is he buried? At the Church of the Sepulchre, outside the camp. Jesus goes outside the camp so that we can stay inside. We are allowed to stay within the camp, even though we are the ones with the disease. We are the ones with the bleeding issue. We are the one with the lifestyle choices. And so in order for God to remain holy, he lets us stay in his holy group and in his holy family. Why? Because tonight, Jesus takes your disease, your issue, your lifestyle that has separated us, and he goes outside the camp for us. A number of years ago, in 2006, Kimberly Deer was on vacation in Missouri. She wanted to go skydiving. So she called up the skydiving agency that Robert Cook worked for, a young Australian skydiving expert, been up multiple times. And she signed up and she said, I want to go skydiving and I want to have this life-changing experience. And in his Aussie accent, he said, well, then come along. And they went through the training and they got the gear together and they got into the Cessna and they began to fly up into the sky. Before they got to an altitude where they could safely jump, the pilot came on air and exclaimed that the engine had shut out. There was nothing they were going to be able to do, and the plane was going down for a sudden impact. They had seconds to live. They were not high enough to get out of the airplane and use their parachutes. The terror of Kimberly knowing that death was surely going to come overwhelmed her, she says. And as she looked to Robert, Robert calmly looked at her and said, I'm going to put my back against the bulkhead of the cockpit. I'm going to sit down on the ground and I want you to sit in my lap. I'm going to put my arms around you. I'm going to cover you. And I want you to put your head right in my neck and I'm going to hold you still. You will make it through. With the fast remaining seconds, she put herself into his embrace. She locked her head next to his neck. She says, I felt his body encompass me. And right then everything went dark as the plane slammed into the ground. The impact of the plane snapped Robert's back immediately. Kimberly still lives to this day because Robert took the blow of death for her. Jesus, the Bible tells us, sticks closer than a brother. He paid our ransom. Amen. I will never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. Jesus goes outside of the camp with my infirmity, with your sin, so that we can still live inside the city of God. Romans tells us that death is imminent for our rebellion, and the wages of that sin is death. But Jesus says, if you will embrace my arms, if you will do what I say, I will take the blow. And even though I die, you can live. All of us in this room, every single one of us, are owed the wages of what we've done, what we've thought, how we've lived. There must be a payment for that. And there's only two responses we can give. We either make the payment ourselves, or we choose to have Christ make the payment for us. There's no other way around it. Payment must be made. Which is why on the cross, when he says in Aramaic, the English, he uses it, we use the English phrase, it is finished. He uses the word tetelestai, which is Aramaic, meaning it is paid in full. The debt has been paid in full. So you're here tonight. Now, if you're a visitor and your friends brought you, you're like, this is not what I thought church was going to be. But if you had cancer and I told you you just had a common cold, I would not be a good doctor. And I'm telling you that God's word says the wages for those sins is death. But the gift of God is eternal life. So I'm going to offer you a choice. You have two ways to live. You can live with you wanting to pay the bill, or you can accept the fact that Christ paid in full. But let us not forget, it was costly. You see, God created us to live in an open relationship with him in paradise. We told God to shove off, and we chose to go with the serpent. I was with a coworker this week who said, how long do you think it lasted when God explained the tree and there was rebellion? I said, personally, I think he was like, look, don't eat from the tree of good and evil. What are you doing? It does not take us long to rebel, does it? What we did this week, what we did last month, what I did last night, it does not take us long to rebel. And there must be payment for that. And the payment was putting him on the cross. People tell me a lot of times, why do bad things happen to good people? And I go, there's no good people. There was only one good man and we killed him. He who knew no sin became the very essence of sin so that we could be declared righteous. You just sang a few minutes ago, I'll never know how much it cost to see my sin upon that cross. Now, I must also tell you a spoiler. The story's not over. But you have to come back to hear the remainder of the story tomorrow or Sunday. But for tonight, you must pause and reflect. Do not speed through this moment. Do not quickly go to the end, even though you grew up watching sitcoms and every show finishes in 30 minutes. With sacredness, slowly know that your rebellion cost him his life. So we will finish in a moment after I pray. I will ask you to quietly make your way out, and you have a chance to worship. Now, normally, our worship involves music and rejoicing and song, but we're going to do a little bit of a different worship tonight. It's not just music, by the way. Worship is not just music. You will make your way out. You'll see a cross. You'll see from the 5:30 service, there's already post-it notes put up there. Some of you know exactly a sin that you know that put him up there. And in an act of worship, you may want to go up to a post-it note and write that sin out there. Don't let shame, don't let guilt be an enemy, okay? Fear is a liar. Do not let fear lie to you at this moment. Be honest. You may want to draw a symbol, but you can put that as an act of worship on that cross and let it be an activity saying, God, I am giving you. I am sorry. I'm sorry. Isn't that what we parents teach our children? That when we do something wrong, we say, I'm sorry. I'm sorry that I've rebelled. Why do we put it on a cross? Because he went on the cross when it was our cross. Let me tell you something about any of y'all. I don't know about you, but I should have been on the cross for what I've done. You should have been on that cross. He went on the cross for us, which is a good thing, which is why it's called Good Friday. So thank you, Jesus, that you went on the cross for me. I am indebted to you. In fact, I've been living as a king. Or you ladies, you've been living as a queen of your own life. And let me just tell you, as kings and queens, we don't know how to rule this world. We've ruined it. If you're the king of your life, you're doing a bad job. This is a fallen world and it's falling apart. You're not doing a good job as a king. So instead, repent and hand it back over to God. That's what he's been asking for since the beginning. I'm sorry that I've rebelled. Thank you that you died. Would you please forgive me and be my king? There's also communion cups out there. You may want to take a communion cup. And if you're with significant others, you may want to spend some time here. You can go home. You may want to do this by yourself until you come back here either tomorrow night or on Sunday morning. And what you'll do is you'll peel off the top layer and you'll take out a wafer, which is bread, which is a symbol of the body of Christ. You will break it. Why? Because he was broken for you. The same way God broke open the Red Sea to let the chosen people walk through on dry ground. He will break, you will break the bread and you will be reminded that in his brokenness, you're made whole. And you'll take and you'll eat. And then you'll peel off a top layer of the foil and you'll see that the cup, which symbolizes wine, which symbolizes blood, And you'll see that his blood was spilt for you. And you'll also recognize that if we have the same blood, we're what? Family. And symbolically, Christ's blood shed for us makes us what? We are reunited with the older brother once again. We are grateful that the one who bled outside of the camp allows us to stay inside the camp. We're able to appreciate and spend some time then in worship with him alone, knowing that he holds us while he takes the brunt of the crash, so we get to live. We're going to pray. And then would you please follow the instructions after we pray on the screen in respect? But Father, we now bow our heads. And we have to come to the reality that our sin put your son there. Our rebellion needed to be paid for. So God, we are sorry. We are sorry that we've rebelled. We are sorry that we are opinionated, subjective people who let our own ideas and ambitions and selfishness rule our lives. Thank you, though, that you went on the cross and that paid the penalty for us. So please, forgive us. Be our King. Anchor, tonight you were loved and you were dismissed.